Good morning and welcome to the 14th meeting of the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee, held in this year 2024. Our agenda item number one is just to agree to take business in private, that being our agenda item four, where we'll be considering our draft A9 report. Are members content to do that?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. That brings us to agenda item two, which is the consideration of our continuing petitions. And we have a number of them this morning. We have five continued petitions to consider, the first of which is petition number 1856. And this is to support the taxi trade, lodged by Pat Rafferty on behalf of Unite, which called on the Parliament to protect the future of the taxi trade by providing financial support to taxi drivers, setting up a national stakeholder group with trade union driver representatives, and reviewing low emission standards and implementation dates. Transport Scotland has confirmed that a meeting was initiated and facilitated by Glasgow City Council with Unite the Union, Energy Saving Trust and Transport Scotland. And colleagues will remember that we actually held an evidence session with representatives from the Taxi Association in relation to the issues raised in this petition and another one, I think, that we had at the same time. Glasgow City Council's recent written submission states that it received 776 applications for a temporary exemption to the LEZ enforcement. All 776 requests were granted. So in short, all taxi operators who applied received the requested exemption. In February this year, conditions were agreed for those who may require an extension beyond the agreed year. And Glasgow City Council granted 225 extensions to the exemption and notes that it will continue to show flexibility to those operators making efforts towards compliance should this be required. So in relation to the issues that we discussed, I think a reasonably pragmatic approach was secured. And do members have any suggestions then in the light of that, how we might proceed? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. In the light of evidence and a collaboration between Glasgow City Council and the taxi trade, I think the committee should close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders. On the basis that the Scottish Government outlined a number of funding options available to support drivers in the taxi trade, grace periods where LEZ restrictions are in place but penalties are not applied have been implemented in Glasgow and could be applied by other local authorities if they wish to do so, and Glasgow City Council has developed a mechanism for eligible taxi operators to receive a temporary exemption to LEZ in order to provide more time to comply. And Transport Scotland has been engaging with Unite the Union to discuss issues pertaining to the taxi trade, particularly in relation to LEZ.
Thank you, Mr. Torrance. Are members, anybody got any alternative suggestions, additional suggestions? Are we content to close the petition on that basis? We are. And so I thank Pat Rafferty on behalf of Unite, and I hope that the action, pragmatic approach that's been taken is one which offers the taxi trade in Glasgow the comfort and support they require. The second of our continued petitions is petition number 1958, which is to extend aftercare for previously looked after young people and remove the continuing care age cap. This is a petition that the committee has taken some considerable interest in during the course of this Parliament, and was lodged by Yasmin Kasaya-Pilling, who I note is with us in the gallery, with colleagues again, on behalf of Who Cares Scotland. Now, the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to extend aftercare provision in Scotland to previously looked after young people who left care before their 16th birthday on the basis of individual need, to extend continuing care throughout care experience people's lives on the basis, again, of individual need, and to ensure care experienced people are able to enjoy lifelong rights and achieve equality with non-care experienced people. Now, this includes ensuring that the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child and the findings of the Promise are fully implemented in Scotland. And in respect of our considerations, we last considered this on the 22nd of November last year. And at that time, we heard from the Minister for Children, Young People and Keeping the Promise and agreed to follow that up by writing to the Minister and also to the Scottish Through Care and Aftercare Forum. We have subsequently received a response from the Scottish Government referencing the support in place to support care experienced people and ongoing with collaboration with the Promise Scotland and other stakeholders to improve the package of support available to care experienced young people. This response also restates the government's commitment to introducing the Promise Bill by the end of the current parliamentary session. Members will have noted that a consultation is now currently underway, aimed at ensuring that young people leaving care and moving into adulthood have the right scaffolding of support available to ensure they thrive. And the Scottish Government consultation will remain open until next week, next Wednesday, the 3rd of next Thursday, the 3rd of October. The Scottish Through Care and Aftercare Forum response sets out its support for the aspirations of the petition, including this removal of arbitrary age criteria, and highlights the focus of the 100 days of listening on identifying solutions to ensure delivery of the promise for all those who move on from care. Now, we've also received two submissions from the petitioner, the first of which responds to the detailed information provided by the Scottish Government, and that submission raises further concerns about the varying levels of current support being provided to young people leaving care across Scotland. Yasmin has also included a practical list of suggestions for improving this scaffold of support available to people who are moving on through care or from care. In our most recent submission, Yasmin provides an overview of the themes raised during this 100 days of listening, which in her view reaffirms the need for the action called for in this petition. So, I mean, this is a petition in which we've expressed considerable interest, a petition in which we've taken evidence, a petition in which the government is now indicating that it is taking action. So the question, I think, for the committee is, what more do we think we can achieve in the time left to us in this Parliament, which, of course, is now more limited than it's been? We could obviously, and we had previously considered a parliamentary debate, but I think it's open to members to consider whether we think we've got enough of an argument given the response of the government at the present time. David Torrance.
Convener, I wonder if the committee considering the government's response and the commitment to a promise bill before the end of a parliament session, if we could close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government is currently consulting on the change required to ensure that young people leaving care and moving into adulthood have the right scaffolding support available to meet their needs, and have committed to introducing the Promise Bill before the end of the current Parliament session. In closing petition, I wonder if the committee could highlight to petitioner, if this is not achieved by the end of a Parliament session, that they can bring a new petition back in the new parliamentary session?
I think the difficulty we've got is the government are making plain that they do propose to bring this legislation forward before the end of the Parliament, which is the aim of the petition. So, Mr. Ewing, have you got any thoughts?
I don't think there's really much more we can do. We've already made our view pretty clear that the current situation is arbitrary and basically impossible to support. I mean, the abrupt and cessation of care as a random age must be arbitrary, and therefore, given the Scottish Government's statement of intention, it's really up to them now to deliver. But, you know, I do feel that should they fail to do so, should there be feet dragging, then I would certainly hope that the matter comes before us again in the form of a new petition.
Yeah. Any other comment, colleagues agreed? I mean, I think that is kind of the position we're in, that the government have now made various commitments as to what they plan to do, but they've set the timeline at the end of the Parliament, which limits our ability to progress things, given that they've said, and will continue to say, that's our intention. But if we find that that's not happened, then there will be a new petitions committee sitting here at the start of the next session. And any fresh petition, of course, can make reference to this petition and the work that was done. And hopefully we will have achieved the ambitions of the petition. But if we haven't, then a fresh petition could be raised at that time. I mean, I'm not comfortable, but I'm not sure, given our ability to act, that there is any more I can positively see us doing at this stage.
I think you're right, Convener, but perhaps we could, in closing the petition, write to the Minister indicating our strong view that there is a duty now on the government to bring forward the legislation,
yeah,
and to do so as quickly as possible. it shouldn't be that complicated.
No,
it's not. So they should really basically get on with it. And that if we sent that message very clearly, then there's a written record that the petitioners and those who have an interest in this, and it is a very serious topic, we've got a very clear steer as the Committee of Parliament that we think this should happen quickly.
Would colleagues be content for us to write to the Minister on that basis, that, you know, we've considered the petition afresh, we've come reluctantly to the view that there's no more this committee can do, but that is in the light of the very specific commitments we've received from the Scottish Government and the unanimous view of the committee that those commitments should be fulfilled during the lifetime of this Parliament? Mr. Choudhury.
What's the chances of asking for a parliamentary debate as well that you've mentioned earlier?
Well, I'm not sure what it would achieve at the moment, because I think the government will say that is what we intend to do. And so that's the difficulty, I think. There's no debate about the substance of the issue. If we were in a dispute and we were advocating a course of action the government were rejecting, there would be the basis for us to argue that case on the floor of the Parliament. But we're not actually arguing against what the government... We're kind of supporting what the government wants to do, but we want them to do it. And I'm not sure that gives us the basis, you know, with the limited amount of debating chamber time that there is to actually construct a narrative that would justify that. Our colleagues contend that we write to the Minister on that basis. So I really do want to thank Jasmine and the others who have been involved in all of this, because their kind of, you know, focus and evidence that they've gave and that we've heard, I think, really persuaded the committee of the case in this regard. And we will write to the Minister, really enclosing the petition as in the terms we've suggested, to ensure that the commitment that we've received is actually fulfilled. But very much, given that the limited time that we now face in this particular Parliament, emphasise in writing again to the petitioner that if that doesn't happen, then as part of the legacy from this Parliament to the next, I hope a fresh petition can be raised with reference to the work that was done. Are colleagues content to act on that basis?
Agreed.
That brings us to petition number 1982 to review funding arrangements for higher education to help ensure more funded places are available for Scottish ballet dancers at the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland. This continued petition is lodged by Gary Mackay, and the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review the funding provided to the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland and help enable more places to be made available to Scottish students pursuing ballet at this level. We last considered this on the 23rd of September last year. The Royal Conservatoire of Scotland's written submission, which I have to say is a much more substantial submission than the one that I think the committee were less than impressed with first time round, does provide the detail about its approach to data collection and dissemination. The submission emphasises that Scottish applicants do not compete for places with applicants from the rest of the UK or international students. Scottish applicants are viewed as an entirely separate category and addition only in a pool consisting of other Scottish applicants. Colleagues, we have also received a further late submission from the petitioner, who continues to be concerned about the ability of Scottish students to actually secure places, believing that there are other criteria which are kind of not entirely consistent with the not reach the right standard rejection notice, because some of those who have received that notice have apparently been accepted at ballet schools elsewhere, particularly the Central School of Ballet in London. Slight difficulty with that is, I suppose, different schools will have different criteria, I imagine, and it's a little bit subjective. I did think that the Royal Conservatoire's more substantive response, which you have before you and which went into a lot more detail, kind of satisfied the disappointment I had last time, albeit I do want to emphasise to them, and I think probably on the committee, that we want to see Scottish students getting the best possible opportunity they can out of national institutions here in Scotland. Mr. Ewing, do you have any comment you wish to make?
Well, I agree, Convener, that the response we have had from the Royal Conservatoire is much more detailed, and to be fair, they have responded to many of the points that I think you raised in the previous hearing. But I think that in practical terms, with reluctance, I think we should close the petition under Rule 15.7 on the basis that the Scottish Government doesn't direct how many funded places individual universities make available for eligible students in specific subjects, except for controlled subjects, that the Scottish Government and Scottish ministers are unable to intervene in internal institutional matters, and it is for the university to decide which courses they offer and how many of their allocation of funded places will be available for each course. So in making that recommendation, I'm conscious of the limitations of the scope of the Scottish Government to do what the petitioner wishes. Having said all that, Convener, I think I do have a lot of sympathy with the petitioner's cause. I did have a constituent some years ago who had virtually the same concern, and it seems to me that, you know, the Royal Conservatoire should very carefully look at its processes to encourage that children, young people from Scotland, are given the opportunity to pursue this specialist area of education and training. And in saying that, whilst the table showing the number of acceptances from Scotland is greater than perhaps I had realised it may be, nonetheless, it's still a very small number. 223, there were six, and 222, there was only three. So it's a very small number, and I think this is an issue that's not going to go away. So I just wanted to put that on the record, because I do hope that the Royal Conservatoire will agree that we have been reasonable in considering their case, but still slightly uneasy about the apparent paucity of places available for Scottish students in a Scottish institution.
I think Mr. Ewing sums up in that last paragraph well, I think, the feelings of the committee, that we do actually appreciate the depth of the response they've given us, but that I think uneasy is the word that I think you used there, Mr. Ewing, which I think would be quite useful in any final letter that we send to the Royal Conservatoire. I mean, is it the view of the committee that in the light of everything we've received, that this is a petition we might move to close?
Okay, Convener. Yeah.
And of course, just lastly, the fresh petition can be lodged within, is it a year, 6 months? So
yeah, 12 months.
So this would be looked at each year, I imagine, by the petitioner and others who have an interest.
Yeah.
So it is possible that if matters deteriorate or don't improve, that the petitioner and others who have a similar concern could bring back this issue in the light of the decisions made this year by the Royal Conservatoire. So maybe that might focus their minds a little bit.
I think that's reasonable. So we're agreed to close it on that basis, but we will send a letter to the Royal Conservatoire explaining that we did appreciate the depth of the response they gave. That did allow the committee to close the petition, but nonetheless that unease is still there about the relatively low number of Scottish students. We hope that they will continue to review and to encourage the best possible talent to apply from within Scotland that allows them to satisfy their entry criteria such that more Scottish students can yet be accommodated. That brings us to petition number 1997, which is to introduce mandatory braille labelling for food products sold in Scotland, lodged by Fiona MacDonald on behalf of Sight Scotland and Sight Scotland Veterans. And colleagues will recall this petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce new legal requirements on retailers to provide braille labelling on food products detailing the name of the item and the items used by or sell by date. We previously considered this petition at our meeting the 22nd of November. We agreed then to write to the UK Department for Environment, Food and Rural Affairs, more commonly known, of course, as DEFRA, and to Food Standards Scotland. The latter have told us that they are looking to use all available relevant science, evidence and research to inform their thinking on the matter. Their response also highlights that no timescale has been set to carry out this work, but they will continue to discuss the issues related to braille food labelling on a UK basis, in line with the common framework for food composition standards and labelling. Food Standards Scotland also say they will continue to keep in touch with the petitioners as their plans develop. In its response to the committee, DEFRA state that there are in fact no immediate plans to initiate a public consultation on the introduction of mandatory Braille labelling in food, noting that factors such as practical viability of Braille labelling on a diverse range of packaging and the costs and the effectiveness of the use of Braille labelling relative to other methods would have to be considered before they did launch a public consultation. We've subsequently also received two submissions from the petitioners, raising concerns that current practices fall short of the UK standards for food labelling and seeks clarification on how compliance with existing standards is in fact monitored. Okay. I think it's a petition that interested us when we first heard it, but quite interesting and comprehensive responses from the organisations and bodies to whom we've written. So I wonder how members think we might proceed. Mr. Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. Considering the evidence that the committee has received, I wonder if the committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that Food Standards Scotland intend to work towards the building of further evidence and knowledge on practicalities and costs to help develop potential options in respect to Braille food labelling. As part of this work, we will discuss the issues on a UK basis through a common framework for food composition standards and labelling. In closing the petition, I wonder if we could highlight to a petitioner that he can bring a petition back in a year's time if they are not happy with the results, and also given that it's a UK-wide approach from the food labelling, if a petitioner may also wish to consider raising the issue through the UK Parliament's petition system.
Thank you, Mr. Torrance. Any other suggestions from colleagues? No? Are we content on that basis? And, I mean, emphasising, obviously, the fact that this, I think, is going to be an issue that is ongoing. I mean, while there's an acceptance of the issues raised, I think the responses we received weren't exactly a call to action at this stage, albeit an indicative suggestion that that might follow at some time. So this might very well be something that could be considered afresh in the next Parliament. That brings us to the last of this morning's continuing petitions, which is petition number 2042 to abolish car parking charges for all Forestry and Land Scotland sites. This has been lodged by Undian Achilles Day on behalf of the Tainault Community Council, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to abolish car parking charges at all Forestry and Land Scotland sites, which would help to promote access to forests and green spaces across Scotland. Again, previously considered at our meeting on the 22nd of November, we agreed then to seek more information from Forestry and Land Scotland. I'm pleased to note that we did receive a response from Forestry and Land Scotland setting out the rationale for car parking charges and doing so at the specific sites and providing details of the revenue received from these charges as well as the management costs of maintaining both its trails and its car parks. The response states that the management of trails and car parks costs Forestry and Land Scotland £5.8 million annually, while the income received from car parks is about £1 million. So we've got a kind of detailed submission with interesting information about sums raised, costs spent. Colleagues, do we have any suggestions as to how we might proceed? Or do any colleagues wish to comment or contribute before we move to suggestions on how to proceed? Nope. Mr. Ewing, you looked like you were bursting to say something, not particularly, or just bursting to say something but thinking better of it.
I don't think bursting is the word I would use. I think Mr. Torrance was planning to say something.
Thank you, Convener. Considering somebody who uses forestry car parks quite a lot in some of the areas in Aviemore and things like that, and the pressures and the additional pressures that are really there now because of the numbers of people who are turning up to these the beautiful locations and the trails. And you can see that £5.8 million is spent repairing them or restoring them, and they're only bringing in £1 million in revenue. I think we should be able to close this petition under 15.7 of standing orders on the basis that car parking charges have been in place at popular forestry and land Scotland sites for over 20 years. A decision to increase the number of forestry and land sites where car parking charges are applied follows on from the Scottish Government's challenge to public bodies to actively seek to increase income from visitors to offset the increasing costs of managing visitors' pressures. Abolishing parking charges at the Forestry and Lands Scotland site would impact substantially on its finances, and Forestry and Lands Scotland highlight the cost of managing trails and car parks is considerably more than the income it receives from parking charges, and also that two-thirds of Forestry and Lands Scotland car parks will remain free from use to the public.
Well, if only the same dedication was shown to filling the potholes in our roads, then we could...
I would agree.
Of course, a petition we considered last week, and I did write to the Minister with Mr Ewing's suggestion about how funds could usefully be transferred from elsewhere, or at least I wrote to somebody, or I closed something, so just to make that point. Mr Torrance's proposal meet with the acceptance of the committee? It does, thank you very much. That brings us to item three, which is the consideration of new petitions. And as always, before we consider them, I'd just say for the record that... In doing so, we initially invite the Parliament's independent research body, SPICE, and also the Scottish Government to give us a preliminary view. That's not in any way to undermine or shortcut our consideration of the petition. It's simply that in previous parliaments, those were the first two things the committee decided it would do, and it allows us, therefore, when we do consider the petition, to have some informed views before us. The first of those new petitions this week is petition number 2097. To repeal the Hate Crime and Public Order Scotland Act of 2021. This has been lodged by Giovanni Di Stefano. It calls on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to immediately repeal the Hate Crime and Public Order Scotland Act 2021. It is the petitioner's view that the legislation is in violation of the European Convention of Human Rights and the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, while also being, in his words, and I quote, impossible for the police to enforce. Now, shortly after the main provisions of this Act came into effect in April of this year, members will recall that Parliament debated a motion to repeal the legislation, which is the objective of the petition, and that that motion did not pass. In its response, the petition of the Scottish Government state that the Act includes, and I quote, rigorous safeguards in free speech and is compatible with the European Convention on Human Rights. So, notwithstanding individual views of the committee in relation to the objective of the petition, it does stand that Parliament has just recently debated and voted on the very matter that the petition seeks to achieve. And unfortunately, for the petitioner and for those who felt similarly, that motion did not pass. So I wonder, in light of that, whether this is a petition that we can usefully take forward, or whether, in fact, in a sense, Parliament has just most recently spoken on it already. I think I'm inclined to take that view, and though so from the chair, I'm inclined to say that on this occasion, I think because of that, the fact we've had that recent vote, that I would move to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that we did exactly what the petition sought to achieve. And for those people who agree with the petitioner and others, sadly, that on the 17th of April, the majority of members voted not to repeal the legislation. Members agreed. Thank you. So, I mean, I thank the petitioner for bringing it forward, but in the particular circumstance that we've just had a vote in Parliament, not long before the summer recess, Parliament has once again expressed its view. The second of our new petitions is petition number 2100, which is ministerial guidance to clarify the criteria for assessing licensing applications under Section 16 of the Wildlife and Countryside Act 1981. This has been lodged by Gary Wall, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to produce guidance under Section 54 of the Nature Conservation Scotland Act of 2004 to clarify the criteria for consideration of no other satisfactory solution in relation to licensing, and to include the sustainable cultural use of natural resources under Section 16 of the Wildlife and Countryside Act of 1981. Now, the petitioner's written submission to the committee notes that the Nature Scot and quotes, can change their will because they have no transparent conservation objective to apply when making a licensing decision on sustainable cultural use. The petitioner is concerned that Nature Scots' application of the satisfactory solution test is not clear and that Scottish Government guidance is therefore required. The Scottish Government's written response to the committee highlights Nature Scots' licensing guidance, which includes specific guidance on the interpretation of the no other satisfactory solution test, The guidance sets out the points considered by Nature Scot when applying this test and notes that where another solution exists, any argument that is not satisfactory will need to be strong and robust. The response states that the Scottish Government has no intention to bring forward, and emphasise this, no intention to bring forward legislation to include the sustainable cultural use of natural resources under Section 16 of the Wildlife and Countryside Act 1981. So the key in all of this does appear to be interpretation of this no other satisfactory solution test and the petitioner's assertion of something which I'm not sure actually is detailed in the way that the petitioner, I believes that it is, together with the fact that the Scottish Government have said that they've no intention of bringing forward legislation, which is, again, a pretty clear steer. So I wonder if colleagues, in the light of that, have any suggestions on how we proceed. David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. Considering the Scottish Government's response, and as you said, it's pretty clear we will not take any legislation forward, I wonder if the committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government has no intention to bring forward legislation to include sustainable culture use of natural resources under Section 16 of the Wildlife and Countryside Act 1981. A Nature Scot provides detailed licence guidance, which includes specific guidance on the interpretation of the No Other Satisfactory Solution test, which considers European Court of Justice case law.
Colleagues, are we agreed? We are agreed. Petition number 2101 to provide defibrillators for all primary and secondary schools in Scotland. This has been lodged by Peter Earle on behalf of Traquair Primary School, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide primary and secondary schools with automated external defibrillators, AEDs. The petition explains that Traquair Primary School pupils discovered that their local defibrillator is in fact too far away to have a positive impact if someone were to suffer cardiac arrest at the school. Now, the Spice briefing notes that in January this year, data obtained through Freedom of Information requests submitted by the Scottish Conservative and Unionist Party showed that approximately 4 in 10 Scottish schools do not currently have a defibrillator. And it's thought that this figure could be an underestimate, as 6 of Scotland's 32 local authorities did not respond to the Freedom of Information requests. The UK government provided AEDs to state schools in England that did not already have one on site to ensure that all state schools had a defibrillator by the end of the 22-23 academic year. The committee has received a response to the petition from the Minister of Public Health and Women's Health. The response highlights the out-of-hospital cardiac arrest strategy, which covers the years 2021 to 2026. One of the strategy's aims is to increase the percentage of OHCA which have a defibrillator applied before the arrival of ambulance services to 20%. The response points out that decisions on the installation and maintenance of defibrillators in schools is a matter for local authorities to consider at the local level. Members will also know that our colleague Finlay Carson has expressed an interest in this petition, is unable to join us today, but did submit a written submission. This is an issue we've come round to before. I mean, it seems something of a no-brainer that these defibrillators should be in place. The other parts of the country are moving to ensure that, or already have moved to ensure that that's the case. The response that we've received is a bit lacking, I think, in that nobody appears to be taking a lead. It's all just being farmed around. And I wonder, colleagues, if anybody's had any similar thoughts or any suggestions as to how we might proceed. David Torrens.
If I could, Convener. I'm going to break with tradition here, and I think it's something that a committee could take forward. It's a very important issue. Defibrillators save lives. And I'm surprised that not every school has them in Scotland. So I wonder if a committee would consider writing to Minister for Public Health and Women's Health to highlight the UK government's provision of defibrillators to all schools in England and to ask whether the Scottish Government will provide direct funding for primary and secondary schools to purchase and install defibrillators.
Yeah, I mean, it does seem invidious that Scottish schools are now behind the standard that's being set elsewhere around the UK, and that 4 in 10 schools, possibly slightly more, in the event that an emergency occurred, wouldn't have access to life-saving equipment, which has a proven track record of being really something that I've seen deployed, and I know other colleagues have heard of instances of its deployment where lives have been saved as a result. So are colleagues content to support Mr. Torrance's recommendation? We are. So we'll keep this petition open, and we will seek to pursue the objectives of trying to get a defibrillator secured for every school in Scotland. Petition number 2102 is to require anyone found guilty of rape or sexual assault to be registered as a sex offender. Fulton MacGregor NSP has expressed an interest in joining us, and I understand will be with the committee shortly. This petition is lodged by Anna Christina Seaver, and the calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to abolish the option of an absolute discharge in cases where the accused is found guilty of rape or sexual assault, and to introduce a statutory minimum sentence for these offences, which includes the convicted person being registered as a sex offender. The Scottish Sentencing Council's information about absolute discharge states that reasons for an absolute discharge can include, for example, that the crime is very minor, that the offender has been previously of good character, or that the offender is very young or old. The Scottish Government statistics show that there were 2 absolute discharges for rape and attempted rape, and 9 for sexual assault in 2021-2022. Now, the petitioner feels that even though the numbers are low, there is no circumstance that is exceptional enough to allow a person found guilty of a sexual assault to go unpunished. The Scottish Government's response notes that when assessing a case, the court will consider the appropriate sentence for each offender before them, taking account of all the relevant facts and circumstances of the particular case. This includes consideration of the fact that absolute discharge will remove the requirement for notification, i.e. being registered as a sex offender. The petitioner's recent submission argues that the current framework has a loophole which excuses those with absolute discharge from their notification requirements. This is because the length of an individual's notification requirement is set by the length of their sentence, and when absolute discharge sets no sentence, this equals no duration in which the individual is subject to notification requirements. And I'm going to use my discretion just to briefly suspend the session, because I understand Mr. MacGregor will be with us shortly, and I know the committee would want to give him an opportunity to comment on the issues raised by the petition. So I suspend briefly. And hello again. Welcome back to the meeting of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee. Just before we suspended, we were considering petition number 2102, which is to require anyone found guilty of rape or sexual assault to be registered as a sex offender. This petition having been lodged by Anna Christina Seaver, and I was able to read out the and to detail the general principles of the petition. Fulton MacGregor MSP has now joined us, and I'm delighted he is going to be able to contribute some thoughts to the committee ahead of our consideration of the actions we might take. Good morning, Mr. MacGregor, and the committee is delighted if you would like to just detail your thoughts to us.
Thank you, Convener. As the committee will be aware, and you've already said, the petition before you calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to abolish the option of an absolute discharge in cases where the accused is found guilty of rape or sexual assault, and introduce a statutory minimum sentence for these offences, which includes a convicted person being registered as a sex offender. I should say that the petitioner is my constituent and has come to meet me about this issue on several occasions, an issue that, of course, she is very passionate about. It should also be noted that I've written to the Cabinet Secretary on this issue as a result of discussions with my constituent, and she has outlined the currently narrow scope whereby someone convicted of a sexual assault can receive an absolute discharge, and some of the reasons that a change in legislation here may be difficult to implement. And with relevant permission of the Cabinet Secretary and my constituent, if the committee were interested, I could share that correspondence. The petitioner also acknowledges that annually an average of three people each year were granted an absolute discharge as a result of receiving a guilty verdict for sexual assault, which underlines the rare circumstances in which this occurs. However, at its core, this petition does seek to address an apparent loophole whereby being convicted of an offence listed in Schedule 3 of the Sexual Offences Act 2003 makes the offender automatically subject to notification requirements, that is, registering as a sex offender. The notification requirements are not dependent on order of the court. An offender who becomes subject to the requirements does so automatically because they have been convicted, cautioned, reprimanded or warned for a relevant offence. There is no discretion exercised by either the courts or the police in imposing the notification requirements on relevant offenders. But, and this is the perceived loophole, absolute discharges do not trigger the notification requirements. In a solemn proceeding, even when an offender receives an absolute discharge, a conviction is still recorded. But despite this conviction, an absolute discharge means that no duration is assigned for notification requirements, creating the said loophole that means the offender is not subject to notification requirements. However, by law, the petitioner feels that this should be an automatic process as part of the conviction. This petition has come at possibly an apt time, as the Scottish Sentencing Council are currently at stage 2 for developing a sentencing guideline on sexual assault and stage 4 for developing sentencing guidelines on rape. As the Council must consult Scottish Ministers and the Lord Advocate before submitting the guidelines to the High Court, there may be some scope for the committee here or the Parliament to impress upon the Scottish Government the nature of this petition and what it is trying to achieve. Ultimately, this petition that my constituent has brought to the Parliament is based on the notion that they have asserted to me very clearly that they do not believe there is any circumstance that is exceptional enough to allow a person convicted of sexual crimes to go without notification requirements. Part of this assertion comes from how difficult these convictions are to obtain right through every part of the criminal justice process, something that the Criminal Justice Committee are very, very aware of. And even for the small number who receive guilty verdicts and then absolute discharge as the sentence, where victims then later learn that there is not even sex offender registration, the impact that can have on victims can also be devastating. So I just wanted to conclude, Convener, by thanking my constituent for bringing this matter to the Parliament, for laying a petition and getting the number of signatures that she did. She's very very passionate about it, and she does want to see change in this area. I'll be continuing to support her in my role as her local MSP. And put back to yourself, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. McGregor. And yes, I think thank you to your constituents as well for raising the issues in the petition. I think there are issues raised here, and I wonder if colleagues have any suggestions as to how we might proceed. Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee would consider writing to the Scottish Government to ask specifically for its views on the petition's ask of abolishing absolute discharge in case of rape or sexual assault and introducing a statutory minimum sentence for these offences.
And do you so just to interrupt, Mr. I think maybe that letter to the Scottish Government, we could draw upon some of the additional suggestions that might be made to them from Mr. McGregor's evidence as well.
Yes. I wonder if the committee would also consider writing to Victim Support Scotland on rape crisis, seeking the views on action called for in the petition. And as Mr. McGregor has already highlighted, I would like to inform the petitioner about the Scottish Sentence Council's consultation on the draft sentences guidelines for rape. And no doubt the petitioner has already engaged with that.
Thank you. Any other comments or suggestions from colleagues? Mr. Ewing.
Yes, I think Mr. McGregor put the case very well, and I did note also that 453 signatures have been obtained, which is a fairly substantial number. So I do support the recommendations that that have been made by Mr. Torrance and yourself, Convener. In addition, I was curious as to, in practice, how many instances of absolute discharge of cases where there had been a conviction for rape or attempted rape or indeed sexual assault arisen, and I've been advised that the figures show there were 2 absolute discharges for rape and attempted rape and 9 for sexual assault in 2021-22. The reason I mention that is that I'd be curious as to whether it's possible to get any explanation as to, without breaking any rule about confidentiality, about why an absolute discharge was granted in these cases, because I think, you know, to any onlooker, it must seem pretty inexplicable that an absolute discharge should be granted, especially for a crime of rape. It's very difficult to understand what circumstances could be so exceptional as would justify such a result, an outcome, where someone is convicted of something as serious as rape. I find it very hard to imagine any circumstances where that would be fair. But, on the other hand, the whole point of discretion to the court is that if there are truly exceptional circumstances, that they do have that discretion. That would be the argument. But I'm sorry, I'm labouring the point a little bit, but I'm just curious as to what the justification was for that outcome in those particular cases. I don't know whether that's possible or not, I think we should certainly try.
Would that be with the Scottish Sentencing Council itself? I mean, would we invite them to try and, insofar as they are able, identify circumstances in which that discharge would have been granted without prejudicing, you know, the particular circumstance of any individual case?
And there's a difficult point, and if they're unable to explain what the circumstances were that merited this surprising outcome, then how can they actually make a judgment going ahead into the future about these matters? In other words, this is a sine qua non of the work that they are apparently doing in looking at the sentences.
So I think, given that we know that they're undertaking a consultation, we note and respect the fact that they are, but to say that the committee would be interested in trying to understand on behalf of both the petitioner and also others who might be looking at the way in which the petition, you know, the issues the petitioner has identified, if they were able to give us some sort of understanding as to how an unconditional discharge might arise as an appropriate sentence. And to say that we do recognise, so, you know, we're not asking for any breach of confidentiality in a specific circumstance, but we would like to try and understand in what, you know, in a more general sense, how that could happen. Because in the face of it, it seems, you know, unpardonable. So we'll keep the petition open. Thank you, Mr. McGregor, for your contribution. And we will, our colleagues content thereby, in addition to Mr. Torrance and Mr. Ewing's suggestions, that we proceed on the basis that we've identified. We are. Thank you very much. Petition number 2104, which is to end the pause on prescribing puberty blockers to children in Scotland, which has been lodged by Sophie Molly, who I think might be with us in the gallery. No, not the gallery, but I noticed that Maggie Chapman is in the gallery, who I think has an interest in the petition. This calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ask the relevant health boards to reassess the decision to pause the prescription of puberty hormone suppressants and gender-affirming hormones for children and young people with gender dysphoria in Scotland, and ensure that it is still possible to provide new prescriptions while a review of the decision takes place. The petitioner tells us that the health and well-being of trans and gender non-conforming children will be adversely affected by the decision to pause new prescriptions of puberty hormone suppressants and gender-affirming hormones to young people. The decision to pause this treatment option is linked to the outcomes of the CAS review of gender services for young people in England. And as members may be aware, the Scottish Government has confirmed it accepts the CAS recommendations in full, with work underway to implement them. Now, in its response to the petition, the Scottish Government has stated its commitment to the improvement of gender identity healthcare in NHS Scotland for all who need it, and draws our attention to a grant awarded to the University of Glasgow to administer a programme of research into the long-term health outcomes of people accessing gender identity healthcare. The response also highlights engagement with NHS England on its planned study into the use of puberty blockers in young people's gender identity healthcare. Now, we've also received a submission from the petitioner highlighting concerns about the quality of data and evidence that was used to inform the recommendations of the CAS review, which, in their view, suggests the resulting decision to halt prescriptions of puberty blockers was ideologically rather than clinically driven. Members may also be aware, and I think this is an important consideration for this committee, that our colleagues on the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee have actually been hearing evidence on the independent review of gender identity services for children and young people. And that, I think, is a matter that obviously may dictate what options we feel are open to us if another committee of Parliament is currently considering the issues raised by the petition. Colleagues, got any thoughts or comments? Mr. Torrens?
Thank you, Convener. As a member of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee, we are already looking into and reviewing the gender identity services for young children and young people. I wonder if a committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Health and Social Care and Sport Committee are currently taking evidence on the independent review of gender identity services for children and young people, including hearing evidence from the Chief Medical Officer at the end of October 2024.
Might we also write to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee, just detailing the petition that we've received, and perhaps recommending that if they are taking evidence from the Chief Medical Officer at the end of October, would it be possible to write to the committee just asking the committee to, in questioning the Chief Medical Officer, make reference to the petition that we've received? With a view to trying to seek an update on the research that is being undertaken specifically on this issue. I'm just conscious that while the Chief Medical Officer is coming to give evidence, it doesn't necessarily follow that the specific issue that is raised by the petition will feature in the questioning put. And I just wonder if it would be possible for us to, in closing the petition, invite the committee to consider whether they might give consideration to asking the issue raised by the petitioner to the Chief Medical Officer? Indeed. Colleagues? I mean, given that there is another committee considering the issue, I'm not sure that, you know, there's much more that we can actively do, given that, you know, generally speaking, we don't consider things in parallel with other committees at the same time. I think that's it's an important issue that's raised by the petitioner. I think the committee is kind of reluctantly minded to close it, but to seek to try and ensure that the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee do understand the fact that a petition has been raised and try to have the issue raised directly with the Chief Medical Officer when the Chief Medical Officer gives evidence. Are we agreed? We are. Petition number 2106, prohibit mobile phone use in Scottish schools. This has been lodged by Adam Senke. It calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to update guidance on mobile phones in schools, to require all schools to prohibit the use of mobile phones during the school day, including at interval and lunchtime. The Spice briefing highlights that decisions on the use of mobile phones in schools is a matter for local authorities or schools themselves. And indeed, I know from examples within my own constituency that there are variable practices applied. In August, the Scottish Government published new guidance, on the use of mobile phones in schools, aimed at empowering head teachers, and I quote, to take steps to limit the use of mobile phones in schools up to and including a full ban on the school estate during the school day, if that is their judgment. Responding to the petition, the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills tells us that she shares the petitioner's concerns about the impact of mobile phone use on children and young people's learning, but states that the Scottish Government cannot unilaterally ban mobile phones in schools. The Cabinet Secretary added during her statement to Parliament earlier this month that updated national guidance goes as far towards a national ban as I am currently able to go. Now, we've received a submission from the petitioner which welcomes the updated guidance, but raises concerns that by leaving the decision up to individual head teachers, risks creating an unequal experience for pupils and their teachers across Scotland. Do members have any comments or suggestions? David Torrance.
Thank you, convener. Considering that the Scottish Government has recently published new guidelines setting out what schools may wish to consider when developing policy on mobile phone usage and engaging with parents, carers and the wider school community, and the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills has stated that the Scottish Government cannot unilaterally ban mobile phones in schools, as this is a policy decision resting with head teachers and local authorities, I wonder if the committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders.
Maurice Golden.
I just wonder if there's just a little bit more in this. I appreciate that guidance has been updated, but I wonder if it's worthwhile, given this is a new petition, giving this issue a bit more of an airing in terms of finding out more evidence around the issue. I mean, the petition perhaps calls on the most extreme form of a ban, but I think there may be iterations of that may produce results. I think there's probably a gap from the Scottish Government in terms of how confident they are that schools are collecting data around mobile phone misuse in terms of understanding the scale of the problem. And I think it would be useful to hear from COSLA, the Association of Directors of Education, Association of Head Teachers and Deputies in Scotland, and School Leaders Scotland, in addition to any individual schools that have applied some form of a ban, which may be state schools or independent schools, and the results in terms of educational attainment around that.
Okay, that's Mr. Turns.
I will vote. Mr. Golding's.
Okay.
But I just wonder, in adding that, I wonder if we could write to teaching unions just to get their views on it as well, because it's their members that will be engaging with them.
Yeah. I mean, I have to say anecdotally, and it is only anecdotal, although first-hand anecdotal, been told by recent school leavers that, in fact, digital learning, pupils are being encouraged to use their mobile phone as a working tool in the classroom to support the digital learning of the particular class in place. And if that is an evolving process in terms of learning, then I'm not quite sure how it's consistent with banning the use of the mobile phone. I mean, I know there was talk at one time of every child being provided with an iPad or a laptop or something. But in the absence of that, how would digital learning proceed in the event there was a total ban? So I was kind of slightly, because that was the response of someone who had recently been at school and thought that there was a contradiction in that, albeit from a school where there were restrictions on when a phone could be used, and it applied variably in different situations within the school. So I'm just interested, perhaps, to write to the Cabinet Secretary for Education to just to understand whether consideration has been given to, in a digital learning era, the phone being a necessary piece of equipment in the same way that a calculator used to be. I mean, can you just say don't use, or is that going to prejudice certain individuals' ability to participate in the learning of the class? I don't know, but I'd quite like to be reassured on that point. Mr. Golden?
I mean, lots of homework is done via mobile phone on Google Classrooms, and that is commonly done in classes as well, in terms of finding out what the homework is and then working off that. It might be interesting to find out how individual schools have implemented restrictions on the Wi-Fi, which restricts particular apps that pupils can access. As well as a kind of parallel issue, there's seems to be a growing increase in panic attacks in among pupils in schools, and without a mobile phone, one of the ways in which that those are mitigated and helped is by calling a parent, and without that, that's going to be difficult to do. Again, I'm anecdotal, but yeah. It'd been useful to hear more about those issues.
Yeah, I'm just slightly concerned it's a minefield, and we should just perhaps try and get a little bit more understanding and information in relation to the issues raised. Are colleagues content to proceed on that on the basis of Mr. Golden and other suggestions that followed to ensure that we understand what's happening? We are. Thank you. That brings us to the end of the open session this morning. We'll be moving to take item 4 in private, and the committee will meet again on Wednesday, the 9th of October, and I therefore suspend the meeting.